He didn't say, he could hear, so he just didn't want to speak. So we said, oh, okay, you know, we started to preach to him. We said, we're from the Hare Krishna movement, and we're preaching Krishna consciousness, and we have these books, and we showed him the Bhagavad Gita. You see, we said, this is the Bhagavad Gita, you can see all the verses, the word for word, the translation, purport, very nice book. So he put on it, he had a board with chalk, and he wrote on the board, how much is it? So we sold him the book. So even though he was doing monograph, even though he had a vow of silence, he could communicate with the devotee, with us. So the mind doesn't stop. So even though you don't speak, the mind is still acting. You're thinking in your mind different things. So it's important that we try to speak words which are pleasing and truthful. That's the mode of goodness. Of course, that's still on the material platform. But if we speak words about Krishna, that is transcendental. That is spiritual. As I said yesterday, there is a Gramya Kata and a Krishna Kata. Gramya Kata is the talk in the village, and Krishna Kata is speaking the glories of Lord Krishna, chanting and singing the songs about Krishna. That is Krishna Kata. So Krishna Kata is spiritual. But the Gramya Kata, the village talk, what are they talking? Politics, they're talking, oh, the price of the vegetables has gone up so much. Oh, there's no rice in the market today. Oh, all the shops are closed. Oh, did you hear about this one? Did you know that one? He got, oh, she died and he got sick and this happened and that happened and their child is different. He'll talk all this. This is the Gramya Kata, the village talk. But the talk of Krishna, that Krishna is Bhagavan, and Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, Sarva Dharma Parigashna, you know, using, speaking about Lord Krishna and repeating Krishna's words from the Bhagavad Gita, that is the real control of the tongue. And that is one of the greatest benefits when you use the tongue to speak about Krishna. So that's the first thing. And then the second thing, manasa, the mind. We have to also control the mind. How to control the mind? Well, the mind is active in thinking, feeling, and willing. Desires, right? The mind, from the mind we have desires. What we want to do, what we like. But from the Bhagavad Gita, we learn that higher than the mind is the intelligence. So we have to control the mind by good intelligence. Use the intelligence so that the mind will be good. Bhagavad Gita says the mind can be the friend, the mind can also be enemy. The mind can elevate us. The mind can degrade us. It depends on how we use it. Just like a knife. The knife can be used to kill, but the knife can be used by the doctor to heal. So it depends how we use it. We have to learn how to use the mind for our benefit. So we learn to use the mind for the service of Krishna. To think about Krishna and to think about doing service for Krishna. Use the mind to think, what should I do today to serve Krishna? Oh, I know, I should go to Aarti. I should go to the Aarti and I should see the deities. I should chant Hare Krishna. And I have to chant my japa. Then I'm going to read the... Use the mind in this way. Use the mind to remember Krishna. So the mind is very important. Control the mind. It's a controlled mind which will make the difference between being happy and being miserable. If we don't control the mind, we will be miserable. But if we control the mind ourselves, we can be happy, we can be joyful. It's up to us to use the mind. So manasa, then krodha vegam. Krodha meaning anger, the urge to become angry. Right? Now probably we all get angry sometimes. Right? You get angry. Then what do? When you get angry? Shout. Maybe even scream. Maybe? No? You don't scream? Some people do. When they get angry, they scream and they shout and they throw things and they, you know, say bad words and do unpleasant, nasty things. Create a very bad atmosphere when people get angry. Now, anger, of course, can be used in the proper way. Just like the example is given. Who used their anger in the service of Krishna?
Who
use
anger?
To serve Krishna.
Hanuman.
Yes. And who else? Who else used their anger for the service of Krishna? Hanuman used it to serve Lord Rama. And who served Lord Krishna? Yes? Who? Serve Krishna? Arjuna. You heard the name? You heard of Arjuna?
Yeah?
No?
Never heard of him.
Arjuna, of course. Arjuna fought on the battle of Kurukshetra. That was his service to Krishna. So they used their anger to serve Krishna. But at days, so sometimes we get angry and difficult to forget. So a little anger sometimes, but it must be controlled, right? Just like you have children, you can't hit them. You may get angry at them, right? You may get angry at them, but you have to just talk to them and tell them, you know, this is not proper. You should behave properly, be good, right? Like that. Some words can be spoken, but you don't beat the child, right? You beat the child will hate you. You're not my mother anymore. Like that. So, you have to control anger. Don't think you can use it in the service of Krishna unless you're in control of your mind and senses. It's very important, right? So, krodha vegam. Then, jiva vegam. The urge to speak. Jiva, not the urge to speak, but the urge of the tongue. Particularly tasting, eating food, the urge to eat food. You know, sometimes we eat too much. Have you ever done that? Did you ever eat too much? Sometimes, eh? Sometimes eat too much. So, the urge of the tongue have to be controlled. Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, don't eat too much, don't eat too little. You can't cannot be a yogi if you eat too much or if you eat too little. You must know how much. So that's good. And also, we should know what to eat and what not to eat. Just like devotees, we don't want to eat meat and fish and egg, these things. We don't want to eat the animal things, impure food. And we don't even eat onion and garlic. That's also something we like to avoid. Onion and garlic, they're very rajasic. They increase the passion. We're already passionate. And if we eat the onion and the garlic, become more passionate. So better to avoid these things. What to eat? Krishna prasad. Eat the food which is offered to Krishna. We want to offer nice food to Krishna. No meat, fish and eggs. Krishna is a vegetarian. So we offer food to Krishna. Krishna also doesn't eat the onion and garlic. Alright, so that's jiva vega. Then udaropasta vega. The belly and the genital. You see the little bit, the tongue, the belly, the genital. If the tongue is not controlled, then what happens? You get a big belly. Right? You put on weight. You get more fat than you need to be. You put on the weight, the belly gets big. And when the belly gets big, then it puts more pressure on the genital and you become more lusty and you can't control material desires. So this is the problem. So these are the things which have etanvigan. These vega, these urges, they have to all be controlled. How many urges? Six. The urge to speak, the mind's demands, the actions of anger, then the urge of the tongue, the belly, and the genital. They all have to be controlled. This is the practice of yoga. Go ahead, Prabhupada writes about the Christian people and the Catholic tradition, Roman Catholic. They will go to church and they will do confession. If you were a Catholic, if you, probably none of you are Catholic, but they have a lot of Catholic people. They go to the church on the Sunday and they make confession. They will tell the priest, "Oh, the other day I stole some money, or I cheated someone, or I did, I did this, and I lied to them," and you tell the priest, and then the priest will say, "Oh, all right, you have to do atonement," and they will say, "Make it atonement, you have to chant," and the Christian, they have a beat, they have what is called rosary, and they chant on the beat, not 108, but 54, half, and they chant on the beat, they chant to Mary, Mother of Hail Mary, Mother of God, have mercy on my soul. They will chant like that. And so a Christian, they will go to church and they will ask to get free from their sin. They will do this atonement or prayaschit, as it's called. But again, you go back every week. And every week it's the same thing. You know, one week I did this, next week I did that, you know, every week it goes on. They don't stop sinning. So, the real atonement, the actual atonement is to become Krishna conscious. To surrender to Krishna. And then, no more sin. Prabhupada said, real atonement involves coming to real knowledge. And for this, there is a standard process. And then Prabhupada explains what is that process by which we can come to real knowledge. The process is practicing Krishna consciousness. And Prabhupada explains things like austerity, brahmacharya, controlling the mind senses, giving up one's possessions in charity, being truthful, keeping clean, doing yoga asanas, all of these things, you can do all, they can help you to come to real knowledge. But the other way you can do it is just simply do Krishna consciousness. Become Krishna conscious. And then don't have to do all of these other things. If you are Krishna conscious, you get the same benefit of all of these other things. Go ahead. Prabhupada explains here from the text. If one is fortunate to get association of a pure devotee, then he can surpass all the practices for controlling the mind by the mystic yoga process, simply by following the regulated principles, Krishna consciousness. Then Prabhupada explains what are the principles. Illicit sex, meat eating, intoxication, gambling, and engaging in the service of the Lord under the direction of the Guru. This easy process is being recommended by Rupa Goswami. So Rupa Goswami is recommending the easy process. The other process, very difficult. What's very difficult? Well, to do all the, give away everything in charity, practice brahmacharya, and then be truthful, and then be very clean, and do yoga asanas, and who can do all of these things? No, very difficult for everybody to do. But everyone can chant Hare Krishna and eat prasada, very easy. So the easy process is Krishna consciousness. Chanting Hare Krishna and eating Krishna prasada. And you get the same benefit. Go ahead. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur's picture is there. He says, he also wrote about, actually Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he found this book, the Upadeshamrita. He found it. Nobody knew about it. Rupa Goswami wrote it, and you know, not many people ever knew about it. But Bhaktivinoda Thakur, what happened was, he knew this one man who was a good devotee, and this one man had been collecting books, and he had a lot of books. So he went to this one man's house one day, and he went through his library, and he was looking at all the books. And when he was looking through all the books, he found this book, Upadeshamrita. And when he found it, and he saw who had written the book, Rupa Goswami, and he thought, oh, very good. And he understood this is a very important book. So he made a copy of it, and he brought it, and he gave it to his son, Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasati. And from Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasati, our own Srila Prabhupada got the book, and he wrote the book. So now the book became famous. But 100 years ago, nobody knew the book. It was very, very few people knew the book. So anyway, Bhaktivinoda Thakur said, the devotees are intent on yukta vairagya. Yukta vairagya means, the vairagya means renunciation. And yukta vairagya means renunciation in relation to Krishna. Just like we renounce meat, fish and eggs, right? But we don't renounce prasada. Right? We don't renounce prasada. We renounce nonsense talk, but we don't renounce chanting Hare Krishna, and we don't renounce Krishna Dutta. So, certain things we give up, but things in relation to Krishna, we don't need to give up. We don't give, but you know, to, we don't have to give up family life. You can live in family life, and you can have children in Krishna consciousness. That is allowed. That is good. That is encouraged. But to live together without marriage, and you know, just to live together just for sense gratification, then that is bad. That is fine. So Bhaktivinoda Thakur said, devotees, they will do yukta vairagya. So they remain aloof from dry renunciation. Dry renunciation means, I will not eat any fruit. Dry renunciation means, I will go and live in the mountain. I will not see any beautiful ladies. I will not have any money. I will not touch any money. That is dry renunciation. Dry renunciation. Sometimes like monkeys. So that is dry renunciation. So we don't do that. Our renunciation is in relation to Krishna. So then he said, the regulation to abandon all contact with the sense objects does not pertain to them. So in yoga, they talk about don't have any connection with the senses. But in Bhakti Yoga, we use the senses for the service of Krishna. We say the senses are given to us by Krishna, and we should use them for Krishna's service. Just like flowers, we will use the nose to smell the flowers after they're offered to Krishna. This is offered to Krishna. And we also wear the flowers which are offered to Krishna. We can wear the garland. We use them. That is spiritual. That is good. We use our eyes to see the deities. We use our legs to walk to the temple and to go to the holy places. We use our legs to go for the Rath Yatra, to walk on the Rath Yatra, and to dance in the kirtan. We use our hands to play the instruments. We use our tongue to chant the holy name. We use our senses for the pleasure of Krishna. We don't stop the senses. You know, sometimes you see the Buddhist, see no evil, hear no evil, speak no evil. So we don't say that. We say, see Krishna, see the deities, hear about Krishna, and speak about Krishna. You see the difference? What is dry renunciation and what is yukta vairagya? Right? You understand? There's two kinds of renunciation. Our renunciation is in relation to Krishna. But the materialistic people or the yogis, artificial renunciation, very dry renunciation. Don't eat. I will not eat. Don't touch any money. Don't look at any people. That is dry renunciation. We don't encourage that kind of renunciation. All right, go ahead. You're at a public function and you have been told the cheese is vegetarian. After the meal, you find out that the cheese actually contained animal rennet. You know rennet? Animal rennet from the hoof of the calf. So they put it in cheese sometimes. You have to be very careful when you purchase cheese. If you make your own paneer, it's okay. But if you purchase cheese in the supermarket, the chances are they put rennet in it. So how do you react? What's your attitude? What do you do? You know, maybe you're a devotee, right? You're a devotee. You don't eat meat, fish, or egg. You don't want to take animal products. So, you don't want to eat animal rennet. So, you're at a public function and they tell you the cheese is vegetarian. And so you go ahead and eat it. But then, after the meal, oh, you know that cheese? Oh, it has rennet in it. Oh, no. What are you going to do? So, what would you do? Any suggestion? Go and have some more, eh? Would you eat more?
No.
No, right? You wouldn't want to eat any more, right? What will you do? Go and find the person who arranged the function and beat him up. Rascal, had me come here and give me meat, give me bread to eat. Beat them. What should we do? So? Well, actually, that is not really the necessary atonement. Of course, we could make a vow that in future, when I go to a public function, I'll be more careful. Right? Next time you go to a public function, won't want to eat the food there, especially if it's something like cheese. Because you can often have rennet. You don't want to eat the rennet. So, that's one thing you can do. Other thing to do, next time you go to a public function, bring your own food. Bring your own food. Or just don't take any food. Just say, I'm sorry, you know, I don't eat outside. Because when we go outside, especially public functions, you don't know who's prepared the food. Just like I was telling, was it the other day I was telling about Ekadasi, that we were doing Ekadasi in the Calcutta temple in Prabhupada's time. And in the Ekadasi, we don't eat grains. And we don't eat beans also. So what happened was, the devotees were serving prasada, and it was supposed to be Ekadasi prasada. So devotees were all sitting, taking prasada, and then all of a sudden somebody said, oh, there's beans in this sabji. So it was a shock. You know, everybody had been eating the vegetable sabji, which had beans in it. So they went to Prabhupada's room and they told Prabhupada, Srila Prabhupada, we've all broken Ekadasi, we've eaten beans. And Prabhupada looked up and said, you all have to fast for 3 days. The devotees were, how will we ever manage 3 days? So then Prabhupada, after some time, he said, you must be more careful. He said, in future, be careful. He said, now tomorrow, you observe the Ekadasi fully. You have to do it tomorrow. So like that, Prabhupada told us. So here in this situation, you've eaten rennet. You didn't do it intentionally, so it wasn't a great offense, but still, devotee is concerned for their own purity, and certainly they know to eat something like that, not good for them. So, they will be more careful in the future, next time. How do we react? Yes? So you always have to check the ingredients to see what's there, what's being used. And we do want to try to avoid these things. Okay, go ahead, Prabhu. Alright, here's some questions for us. Number one, when is it all right to eat in the home of life members who invite us? So we have the program, you know, there's a life membership program. People become life members. And sometimes the life members will invite us to their home to do a program. And maybe they want to have some kirtan in their home, and we'll go to their home. So then the life member, of course, he likes to also feed you. So, when is it all right to eat in the home of the life member? So, standard is they must be fully vegetarian. No meat, fish, or egg. They must not cook even the onion and the garlic. We don't want to eat this. Ideally, they should be devotees. They should be, you know, following the principles just like we follow. When is it all right to eat in their home? Well, if you're sure that their home is sattvic, in other words, that they don't keep any animal food there. They don't cook any meat or fish or egg, then it's all right to take something in them. But generally, it's safer. You can just take some fruit. Srila Prabhupada said, just take some uncut fruit. Why uncut fruit? Because they use the knife to cut. And usually, if they're cutting meat or fish or like that, so that then you use the same knife to cut the fruit. So better that the fruit should be uncut. So that is the safe thing to do. People want to feed you, you see, just give me some uncut fruit. Like, how important is it not to eat food cooked by karmis? Karmis mean non-devotees. It's very important not to eat food cooked by karma. Why? Because it affects the mind. The consciousness of the people cooking will affect our minds. If you eat food cooked by someone who's a meat eater, then it will affect that. The karma comes through the food. The consciousness goes into the food, and we eat the food, it affects us. We have to be very careful what we eat and where we eat. Now, sometimes, of course, Prabhupada would be traveling in India, be on the train, like that. So sometimes he would purchase from the platform, purchase from the person cooking. So he would see the food prepared. He would see the food prepared. And because you pay for something, then that neutralizes some of the karma. When you pay for something, then that neutralizes the effects of the karma that you're doing. But that should be only in special situations. Maybe you're traveling, you don't have any choice, so you have to get something, so you make arrangements like that. Number three, when can we eat food cooked by machines? Food cooked by machines. You get fast food, right? Noodles and things like that, cooked by machines. So when can we eat that? Well, you can eat it when you have nothing else to eat. If you have nothing else to eat, then you can eat that kind of food. It's not the best. It's more what, that's what we call junk food. It's not healthy, and it's not really good to offer to Krishna. But again, you have to consider time and the place and the circumstances. And if you have nothing else to eat, then you can eat that. And finally, should we eat the meals provided on airplanes? Well, not recommended. Not recommended. When Srila Prabhupada used to travel, he always brought his own food with him. He would always carry a tiffin with him and he would take his own prasadam. He never wanted to eat any of the food in the airplane. Food cooked in the airplane, of course, going to be cooked by non-devotees, not very pure, not recommended. Those are some simple questions which we need to understand. Alright, go ahead, Prabhu. Okay, go ahead. Alright, so we'll just review what we covered here for this first lesson. So we have the overview of the Upanishadamrita. What different topics the verses are going to discuss. And we explained also the purpose of the Upanishadamrita. The purpose is that we will become Goswamis, that we will also become Goswamis, and we will also become better devotees. So that's the understanding, and then the application. How the study of Upanishadamrita could help to improve our attitude in Krishna consciousness. Our attitude, by studying this Upanishadamrita, by understanding things like these urges and controlling them and learning what is good for devotional service and what is not good, this will help us to improve our attitude. And then the appropriate means of controlling the six urges with reference to text 1. Appropriate means controlling the urges. How to control the urge? By Krishna consciousness. The urge to speak about Krishna. The urge to eat Krishna prasadam. Anger, be very careful not to use anger. Try to control it. Sometimes you get angry, what you should do? Go out. Just go out and chant Hare Krishna and calm down. Calm yourself. Control the mind. So that's better than becoming very angry. And the mind, how to control the mind? By hearing about Krishna, by chanting. When we chant, we want to hear. Use the mind to hear the Maha Mantra. So the mind can be focused in Krishna consciousness. Very important to fix the mind on the lotus feet of Krishna. And then you can control these six energies. Alright, any question? Okay, thank you very much. I think that's it. Is it Prabhu? No more slides after this. Oh, Mudra Mission. Oh yeah, we talked about Rupa Goswami. Rupa Goswami, they said he is Rupa Manjari. And Rupa Goswami, he was responsible for writing books, important books, based on the teachings he got from Lord Chaitanya. And one of the books is the book we're studying, the Upadeshamrita, and the other book is the Nectar of Devotion. So Rupa Goswami is a very important person in the mission of Lord Chaitanya. And Krishna consciousness is under the control of Rupa Goswami, conducting under Srila Rupa Goswami. Because his book teaches us how to do devotional service. Just like Nectar of Devotion, Prabhupada said, that is the handbook for the devotees. So we have to read these books and learn what's in these books and then apply that knowledge in our practice of devotional service. In this way, Rupa Goswami is teaching us how we can become Krishna conscious. Go ahead. Okay, here's a quote from Srila Prabhupada. In all spiritual affairs, one's first duty is to control his mind and his senses. Unless one controls his mind and senses, one cannot make any advancement in spiritual life. Everyone in this material life is engrossed in the modes of passion and ignorance. Go ahead. One must promote himself to the platform of goodness, sattva gun, by following the instruction of Rupa Goswami, and then everything concerning how to make future progress will be revealed. So Rupa Goswami is bringing us up to the mode of goodness, and from the mode of goodness we can go on to the transcendental platform, devotional service on the transcendental platform. So this is the benefit we get from reading Nectar of Devotion and Nectar of Instruction. These books, they help us to get free from Rajagun and Tamagun and to come up to the spiritual platform. Yes? This is the Samadhi, Rupa Goswami's Samadhi in Vrindavan. That's how it used to be anyway. In recent times, there's been a lot of construction. They put a whole building over the top of it. And so if you go to Vrindavan now, you won't recognize it. The tree there, you can cut down, and they put a building over the top of the Samadhi. You can go into the building. The Samadhi is still there, of course. But they just enclose the whole thing in a building.
Okay.
Krishna, Shri Prabhupada ki jai.
Hare Krishna.
Okay,
the model slogan in the Uddesha Mardala. Plus, check Naliki. Naliki do activity, do a program with it, and the Saturday program. You conduct Asta Aradhya tomorrow. The program, plus, Asta Aradhya.